Okay, we are ready. This is the first one.
Yeah.
When is necessary to change slide, if you want, you can say next one, and we go. All right?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I would like to thank to the organizers for giving me this opportunity and considering my request to make this presentation through Skype. I and my colleague not make it as a meeting we were moved up to and I was advised not to travel. And my colleague's father has passed away months ago. But I'm happy to contribute the topic to discuss. And my presentation is also available if anybody is looking at it. The topic which I was asked to speak is on access to medicines and treatment. The access to medicines and treatment at affordable prices is one of the biggest challenges in the era of profit, attendance, and pricing. As a state, rural population lacks reliable access to needed medicines. So I would like to look at my talk in the Human Rights Network next week. This is where I think, you know, health is a human right. So I would like to, you know, speak under a framework where states have obligation as the right to health, ensure that medicines are available, financially affordable, and physically accessible on the basis of non-discrimination to everyone within their jurisdiction. Therefore, access to medicines forms an indispensable part of the right to health. I don't want to read because it will be there, so we can go on to the next slide. Next. So what are the global commitments? You know, one thing which I could bring it here is the global commitment to ensure that to health. One such example is the Sustainable Development Goals, where the goal, it says very clearly, ensuring a healthy lives and promoting well-being for all at all ages. And the goal 3 has two targets very clearly. One is target 3.8 and other is target 3.8. Both speak about access to medicines. Just to give an example, target 3.8, it says achieve universal health coverage including financial risk protection, access to quality healthcare services, and access to safe, effective, quality, and affordable essential medicines and vaccines for all. So the next 3P also speak the same thing. So both of them are actually reiterating the need for ensuring access to medicines. Next, please. See, what are the global issues? One of the global issues is the national team flavor, such as the World Trade Organization and IMF and World Bank, that creating policies in regard to trade, patents, and intellectual property laws has a direct impact on activities and for therapy or treatment. So many of pharmaceutical companies, pharmaceutical companies are based in developed countries who have more capital, resources, and infrastructure, influencing the international policy, increased trade agreements, which favor these companies, reflect in the imbalance of power, which is actually the disparities. Next, please. Similarly, I think sometimes my slides may be matching because I'm skipping many of the slides of the presentation. When I spoke for the sustainable development, I have a click on the entire approach of the SDGs. The much touted sustainable development goals, like the 3 basic sustainable development goals, they aim to transform global reality and inequality. However, neither are the targets and indicators exhaustive to fully present the transformative potential. Apart from piecemeal changes to be achieved in the course of the years, what they have said. So the compass for to leave no one behind, that is the slogan of SDG. It actually obviously emphasizes on equity and redistribution of resources for the benefit of most marginalized people. So, next please. Or we can skip this too. So let's see through some of our recent experiences which we have faced at ground level in India. This is the reality. It's a 6-year-old child from the village in India, died of diphtheria in June 2017 at a government hospital. And the reason is there is no availability of the diphtheria antitoxin or the anti-diphtheria serum for the treatment. I think you need to change the slide. Yeah. And another example I would like to give here is the 290 children died in the month of August this year. At one medical hospital in one of the states in India. Of the total 290 children who died, 117 children died in the neonatal unit. The reason is the short oxygen. So in India, please. You can see the picture which is clearly showing the creation of the hospital and which I spoke about lack of oxygen, 290 children who died. So, the next please. Next. Okay. I just want to bring here another example. It's about India every year. Roughly 5.8 million Indians die from heart, lung diseases, stroke, cancer, and diabetes. For example, in India, the prevalence of cancer is estimated to be about 6.5 million people with new infections every year, and 550,000 deaths after the year due to cancer. Next, please. It is one of the states in northern province of Bhumika. Every day a 12-coach train, known as cancer train, has around 100 cancer patients. Daily, they travel daily to the human for the treatment because treatment is very expensive and not available in that particular area. So it is called a cancer train. You can see there is a picture in the presentation. Because cancer is most expensive, with hospital-like case, we are around 1,100 dollars in the private and public sector. So cancer treatment is the most expensive. That we want to bring in like my presentation of the pregnant subjects. Episodes which I spoke, whether it is diphtheria or the cancer, or talking about non-communicable diseases, are not merely unfortunate circumstances due to threats of violations, rather reflect lack of stability. So what are these stomach issues in India? Next, please. Next. Yeah. The systemic issues on the existing public health system, low public health investments, poor infrastructure, including diagnostics, adequate skilled resources, and the other issue is which seminar is the increasing privatization and corporatization of healthcare, the absence of robust regulation. And the other major issue is the lowest GDP, that is gross domestic product, expenditure on health, coupled with high out-of-pocket expenses. So the government spent on this year 1.15% of GDP. This is about 0.8% of the total government expenditure. And our neighboring countries like Bangladesh and Nepal, Sri Lanka, they spend much more GDP on health compared to India. And it is barely 1.9, they exactly on the WHO's this much of invest almost 5% GDP on health. So you can see the lack of interest in spending on the healthcare. Next, please. Next. From the issue of the healthcare, I'd like to move on to the pharmaceutical industry, which is very much linked with the presentation. I'm talking about the pharmaceutical industry in here, the pharmaceutical industry, one of the highest in the world and the third largest, accounting for 10% of overall production stands 14 in terms of the market value. So we rank 14. And it has an annual turnover of $30 billion and exported drugs worth $50 billion, more than 200 countries. So India has a strong generic industry with 70% of the market share in terms of the revenue. India supplies 20% of global domestic market exports in terms of volume. The country is the largest producer of generic medicines globally. So despite impressive growth in the Indian pharmaceutical industry, the availability of medicines is still very poor. Also, medicines are very high. So what effects happens to medicines? I think this is very important for us to look into. And what are the reasons? Why, at one level we are saying we have a low pharmaceutical industry, at the other level children are dying with lack of oxygen or lack of life-saving medicines. So I would like to speak for a minute on So one is the availability of the medicines and affordability of the medicines, which you can see on the slide. And both are affected by patents of pharmaceutical products, as it stopped generic production of the drugs. After 2005, product patent, next slide please. Next slide. Yeah. After 2005, the final product patent is easily to change the process. So after 2005 product patent of the same final product is patented. Earlier, India had only process patent for pharma drugs, but not with product and process patent. A lot of research in pharmaceutical products nowadays takes place previously, which is bought by the pharma company. And the pharma companies then patent the products and keep the prices high. So, pharma does invest in research and development. They spend a lot more on themselves and on advertisements. So, once you patent the brand to the pharmaceutical product, generics cannot manufacture, say, for 20 years. Only one compulsory license has been issued in the last 12 years of the new patent regime. There is a move towards voluntary licenses. The only company involved with a patent, including big pharma companies. So these voluntary licenses are not open to transparent and can control the case from where the active pharmaceutical ingredient is to be bought and the area where the generic companies can sell the product. Right. So this is the effect of the license regime. Next, please. I'm just giving an example of the hepatitis C treatment. I'm not going to read because I do not have much time, but I really request you to go through my PPT and then you can understand what is the situation. So you can see the Hep C treatment cost. I tried to give it to US dollars on EU in the euros. That is a picture of the Hep C, and you can also look at the cancer treatment. So you can, the next please. So the cancer treatment first, next slide. I'm not reading out because it's very the same with cancer treatment, you can see the imaginative massive and it is $1,800 USD, and then same with psoriasis, you can see the obstructive. All of the best and not acceptable to any Indian population if you are in the higher group type, their income group too. The next brand I gave table before, which I couldn't convert into the euros or dollars. Next slide, please. Yeah, you can see the highly priced patented medicines marketed in India in 2015. You can get it. Most of them are anti-cancer, or some of them are the Aricalis, Riptide, Arthritis, and some are anti-infection and anti-diabetic. Next, please. So one example, you know, which I kept it low. I'm not going to speak because it is going to be quite my. I would like everyone to taste of tough mouth and there no patents yet. That is not accepted back. The entire family has been explained in my slides. So I request all of you to read because it may be more than that if I'm going to read for this. The next. So at the end, the next piece, you can see the, you know, the article in Nature where Roche picks up Indian pattern breast cancer because of the campaign. Next. I'm skipping off it because I'm not having kind of time now. So what I'm trying to talk is about the trade agreements of 2005, where through the trade agreements, developed countries have been attempting to obtain additional life protection. And next. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Thanks. Yeah, that of the biggest threat. The trade, of course. So through trade agreement level companies in looking to obtain additional IP protection and enforce provision beyond this. And it is also priority to fix flexibility. And these agreements are negotiated secretly without any transparency, without actual political consent. That is what is important. And how will these trade agreements affect access to medicines? One is by allowing increased IP protection for medicines that will enable establishment or extension of the monopolies. How by allowing IP to take steps that would show our delay in this competition? How by running the smart in right to the governments to take steps to ensure that the right of health is protected in some of it? I'm not reading all other things which are very clearly in the presentation. Next. Yeah, this just to show you the FDA and next please. This is again the implementing the FIPS flexibility because we do not have time, so I'm just skipping it. There are external pressures, you know, which you can see very clearly now. The next slide is clearly indicating. Please come to the next slide. So you can see the FIPS pressing key. Now and against the price gap, medical violence. And they say India needs to hold cash above. So US medical device is the alleged denial of equitable market access as a strategy to protect an equitable market at the cost of the people's lives. The same thing you can read in the article, you know, again they are going to in a way, like, you know, trying to control is what they are doing in the recent last 2 months. And a very recently, just next slide, yeah, USP viral growth of 18 million Indian pharma firms. So this is what is happening now when we are trying to resist for the other pressures which are happening on India change the strategies. And control. So what is our goal from the ecosystem? Have some recommendations to make. One is that the framework practice, which makes it very clear that medicine must be available, visible, accessible, and of good quality to reach aging populations without discrimination throughout the world. The second is lower and middle income countries. They should review their law or the policies and consider whether they can give full use fixed flexibilities or include fixed plus measures, and if necessary, consider amending their law and policies to make and if developing LMICs should establish high potential equity standards and provide for exclusions of patentability, such as new forms and new forms tech uses and complications in order to work and facilitate delivery of the medicines. Next point is government should be more transparent and open to their dealings with MNCs, that is multinational companies, and other countries while negotiating FTAs, that is trade agreements, and similar agreements. And we need to develop a proper system to scrutinize patent applications, such as such that patents are not granted for pharmaceutical products that are not legally invented, not to link the approval process of the drugs with the patent system, which we are trying to demand here, and no need of exclusivity should be allowed on pharmaceutical products. The prices of the medicines, so the prices of the medicines, such as medicines are available and affordable and also at the larger global level and also at the Indian level, because some of the things are specific to India. I'll just take two points. At country level, the most important barrier to access to medicine in India is because the public and it is almost collapsed, as I said in the beginning. And clearly, this strategic entry of access has to be premised on a major expansion and reorientation of the public health system through which medicines would be available free of cost. And since more than half of the healthcare expenditure in India is accounted for by the private purchased medicine, it is imperative to promote free drug and diagnostic, which is supposed to be the, you know, the responsibility of the system, and particularly the marginal communities. And there is a need to increase the health budgets, as India's GDP health is less than 2%, and drug procurement and distribution to the public health system should be. And a new vision for the research and development in the pharmaceutical sector is required, but it is based on hands of public investment, not in the private sector or not in the private, with the private patient support or private institution, but it should be in the government, state funded, or state invested. Thank you
so much. Thank you very much. We will send you all the speech of our conference. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.